Fran again at the bench, yada yada yada. But this is one of those feedback episodes. Feedback, because I made some videos in the past week, a lot of comments and a lot of discussion. And so I thought I would address some questions that have been posed by viewers in the comments and add a few things about videos I've made recently and yada yada. And some ranting and pointing. They'll be ranting and pointing. So you know it'll be a good one. Okay. Every now and then I get people complaining in comments that they're angry or frustrated or upset that I'm not looking directly in the camera. So I don't know what it is. I mean, see, I'm autistic, so I don't get the whole eye contact thing. Because when people are talking, I tend to look at their mouth rather than their eyes, although there's a thing where, you know, I had to learn how to look people in the eye when I'm talking to them. But generally, I don't look at people in the eye when I'm actually talking. The camera's even harder because it's just a machine. It's like there's nowhere to look at, you know. But people that say that I'm not looking right in the camera say, well, which eye are you looking at? Because I'm right-eye dominant, so, you know, I'm looking at the camera. It's like I'm looking at the camera with one eye and the other eye is kind of looking like over there. So, because I'm wally-eyed, it doesn't affect my depth perception or anything because vision, at least for humans, vision is all in the processing. It's not actually in the physical, you know, structure of the eye. The raw feed from our eyes is horrible because, you know, I mean, the light sensing cells are actually behind the circulatory system, and we have a blind spot in the middle where the optical nerve goes in, like right, almost right in the dead center, and we have all these issues. So all, you know, sight for a human being is all done in the processing. So even though my eyes don't line up and I'm wally-eyed, in my brain, the two images are perfectly lined up and I have a perfect depth perception and everything. But hey, you know, you got to choose which eye you're looking at, you know, which eye do you want to look at? Which eye is looking at the camera now? Which eye is looking at the camera now? So there you go. Pick one. All right, so my light bulb video. A lot of comments, and as you'd expect from something like this, a lot of people choosing sides, but there's no sides to choose from my point of view, because I'm absolutely 100% a supporter of renewable energy and green energy and everything, and I'm completely in support of getting electrical consumption down. I've switched out all of my lighting. You know, when fluorescent lighting, the compact fluorescent lighting became popular, I switched from tungsten to fluorescence. And then when LEDs came out and started being like really reliable and a little more affordable, I started swapping out to solid state. Now I'm pretty much all solid state with only a few exceptions, but that doesn't mean that I can't be aware of issues related to solid state lighting and such. And I think that the carbon footprint of these more complex lighting fixtures is significant enough to warrant a discussion. Now, some people pose a very interesting thing, which is, and it really begs the question, why don't we have low voltage power distribution now? Because we have this, you know, low voltage lighting, and a lot of stuff runs on low voltage, a lot of battery operated stuff, chargers. You know, it really begs the idea that if we had like especially like in cities and stuff, like citywide, you know, 5-volt power distribution. I think some studies have been done about power distribution and stuff. Like if we had like basically like one big power supply to supply even like a whole building, like 5-volt supply, you know, high current, low voltage for lighting, chargers, all that stuff, you know, it would really drop cost a lot. And the idea that like LED lighting fixtures wouldn't have to have all the complicated electronics in them, if they were hooked up to a high current, low voltage power source, it would be much simpler to regulate them down with just a little bit of resistance and just, you know, passive ways of limiting the current that the LEDs take. It really would be a good idea, and it's something I really haven't heard talked about, but maybe the time has come to have like household-wide and apartment building-wide low voltage supplies for lighting and other low voltage appliances and stuff. It would cut energy costs a lot and cut a lot of the carbon footprint of manufacturing all of these little power supplies to go in all these bulbs. It's just kind of ridiculous. But the other thing about this, you know, there's a lot of kind of people saying, oh, green energy is bunk, and you know, electric cars are bunk, and wind turbines are bunk. They're not bunk. You can't throw the baby out with the bathwater. It's not a black and white issue. There's this big gray area where it's all about returns. So I run all LED lighting for the most part. I think I've got some still some fluorescent lightings in, you know, in the shop and stuff, just because I have so much of it. I just want to keep using it. But just because I have concerns about the carbon footprint of some of these lighting fixtures, I'm absolutely in support of green energy and renewable energy. But I think you got to be sensible and think about exactly what you're buying. You know, in Philadelphia, people want to run electric cars, and that's fine. I fully support electric vehicles. But if you're driving an electric car in the city, I just don't want people to have the belief that they're living green, because you're not. It's just not how it works. If you live in the sticks, probably the amount of green energy that you get is much more uniform on the grid. But the power grid, just like any other power supply, where the loads are heaviest, like in large cities and industrial sectors, the majority of the power that's consumed at the high load area is generated closest to the point of the load. That's just sort of how it goes, which is why they have so many power stations built up around major cities and industrial sectors and such. You know, you want to limit the transmission line length where the loads are high to where you can generate, and you don't have the, you know, it's all about efficiency. You don't want to have high loss. You know, the further away you put the power generation to the load, the more heat you generate in the system, the more loss you generate, and yada yada. So, I mean, nationwide in the U.S., nuclear energy is about 20%, give or take, in the U.S. for like the total, you know, power generation. Renewables, I think, is somewhere around 17-18%. So, at least in the United States, uniformly across the United States, it's like 62-63%. Of all the power generation is still fossil fuels. It's mostly natural gas now, but it's still a lot of coal. So in the city, here in Philadelphia, I haven't seen them in a while, but it used to be that, you know, you'd find these people set up with these tables outside supermarkets and stuff, live on green energy, and, you know, sign up, and if you sign up here and buy your energy completely renewable, you'll be running completely renewable energy. And I would say, look, it doesn't work that way. It's like, if you sign up for this, and I totally agree with doing this, by the way, if you sign up to get your energy from a renewable source, you're not actually using that energy. You're supporting that generating station with your utility bill, which is absolutely fine. I totally agree with that. But having the mistaken belief that the electricity that you're using is green, it doesn't work that way. Because if you live in Philadelphia, probably close to 100% of the energy you consume is produced by fossil fuels. And that doesn't change just because you support the wind farm or the solar generating station, whatever, that's thousands of miles away or whatever. You know, if you support a wind turbine farm, that's fine. That's great. I support that. But just don't believe that all of the current that you're using in your apartment in the middle of the city is now green. It's not. It doesn't work that way. It's two different things. I mean, I don't mind people selling. I certainly don't mind the idea of selling green energy. I think people should support green energy, and people should support utilities that generate clean power. Absolutely. 100%. But I disagree with the idea that, having done that, that people believe that they're living off of green energy, because it doesn't work that way. You're still living off the fossil fuels. And so, like, people who drive their electric cars in the city, you're just moving the tailpipe, because unless you've got your own solar array and you're charging your car from your own solar array from your house, you know, if your car's getting power off the grid, then you're driving that electric car on natural gas. You just moved the tailpipe from the car to the natural gas generating station that's, you know, just outside the city. That's where the power is coming from. So it's just, you know, I just want people to be clear about that. I agree 100% that we need to get off fossil fuels. We need to get on renewables. We need to drop our energy consumption, all that, 100%. I just have a problem with people believing one thing when the truth is other. And I think that the mistake is when people believe that they're living green when they're not, they take their hands off the wheel. You know, they stop being active in trying to get fossil fuels, you know, replaced with clean energy. You know, they sort of just, you know, say, oh, I've done my part, you know, I'm living green. But no, it's like, you got to really actually get rid of these coal plants. You actually have to shut down the natural gas generators and replace them with something else. And that's a huge, huge task and a totally different argument altogether. It's the same thing with pump gas. You know, people think, oh, I only drive, you know, BP gas, or I only buy Gulf gas, or I only buy Shell gas. Well, pump gas is pump gas. You know, in the United States, there is no such thing as this as branded gasoline. It's all generic gas because there's a gas pipeline, distribution pipeline that goes throughout the country, and every manufacturer puts gas into that pipeline and they all withdraw. But the gas they get out isn't the gas they put in. It's like money. It's like, you know, you put your money in the bank, and then the money you take out of the bank isn't the exact money you put in the bank. That's how pump gas works. And so all gas is just gas, and all electricity is just electricity. You can't pick and choose the electrons, where they come from. And the reality is, until we have major change where we actually have the majority of power generation being renewable, we're still living off fossil fuel. So don't fool yourself, but support green energy, 100%. That's the truth. Okay. It came up in a discussion amongst my fellow EUtubers. I didn't even kind of realize it, but YouTube shut off email notifications. I guess they did this kind of quietly, because even like a lot of us weren't really aware of it. But yeah, if you have it set up to see a new FranLab video by email notification, you're not going to get that anymore because YouTube has stopped doing it. So, go figure. You just have to check in every now and again. It's just one of those things that makes it harder to get subscribers to, you know, watch a new video. Even if people are subscribed, unless you're checking in on the channel every now and then, the YouTube really isn't letting people know that there's new videos out on channel. So there you go. Gotta check in, subscribers. Batteries, you know, I just did a battery video. It just went up today about, well, today isn't today because this video is actually on Patreon today, but you're watching it tomorrow. So a few days ago, I put the video up about replacing my motorcycle battery. And I've been doing lots of videos about battery problems, and I really just knuckled down and decided I just wasn't going to buy alkaline AA's and AAA's anymore. I've gone to lithium, so I'm just, you know, it's a lot more expensive, but you know, I'm tired of throwing out stuff that gets ruined because of leaky batteries. So I'm going lithium, trying the lithium out. These are the Energizer lithiums, 100% leak proof guarantee, 100%. I'm also trying out these AnyLoops. These are nickel metal hydride cells, or NiMH. It's not as easy to say as NiCad, but NiMH cells. Yeah, so they. I'm going to try these out in like things like my card shuffler, where, you know, it's like it doesn't really care about the voltage so much. I think these actually run a little low. I think it's like a 1.2 volts. As typical, let me check here. I read that they run a little low. I may have to actually check them. Let's see here. But these AnyLoop cells, they come fully charged and ready to go, so you don't actually have to charge them like first off. 1.3. So yeah, but they're not like 1.4. I think the lithium cells, I'm going to crack this open. The lithium cells run the other way. I think they run a little hot. Let's see. Okay. Lithium cell. Lithium. Lithium cells. Let's see here. Fresh out of the pack. Yeah, 1.8. So lithium cells run kind of hot. and the NiHMA cells, nickel metal hydride, they run a little low. So choosing like the kind of like cell to use, there are certain things, I mean, that running like 1.8 volts. So if you've got like a 6-volt device that takes like four double A's, if you're using the lithium batteries, they're 1.8 volts a piece. You put in the new batteries, you're pushing 7.5 volts, give or take, you know, like 7.2 to 7.5 volts. That's a lot of overage. So there are some things that you might not be able to put a lithium cell in just because it's going to over voltage, or if it's got like a you know, if you're running an appliance that has like a voltage regulator in it to drop like 6 volts down to 5 or something, you're pushing it an extra 1.5 volts over, you might, you know, cook the voltage regulator or whatever. There are some issues with these battery voltages, and that with the nickel metal hydride cells too, you know, being a little under voltage, they might not quite have enough to run something. So yeah, but I'm trying them out. I think that I read on the wiki page that the nickel metal hydrides are basically the same kind of basic construction as NiCad cells, just they don't have the cadmium in them. They use a hydrogen absorbing alloy, that's what it says, instead of the cadmium. So it's but it basically runs the same way. But the energy delivery and storage is close to a lithium cell, so I'm going to try them out. Lastly, the Pedal Mom video I put up, it's the first in a series. I'm going to do more pedal videos. Yes, more Pedal Mom videos. A lot of people asked in comments, why are you wrapping up the battery? Well, I wrapped up the battery in that video because it's the way that I made that prototype, there's no battery compartment. The battery kind of sits on top of the circuit board next to the switch. So the battery that was in there that was from like 1995 or whatever, I don't know when, it was like 94, 95, but that battery leaked out, I took it out, but I had wrapped that original battery in electrical tape so that it wouldn't short things out. That's why I wrapped the battery in paper. It's just so I could put it in the case and test the pedal without it shorting out everything, because the case on the battery was, you know, metal, was probably conductive or could have been conductive, so that's why I did it. The other question I get asked, someone I think put a comment, why do you call it a pedal when it's not a pedal? You know, pedal goes like this, like a gas pedal or a brake pedal, you know, where you put your foot and you move it. It's a good question, and I actually was asked this question. I answered that question when I was interviewed for the Pedal movie, which is yet to come out. It's going to be coming out, I think January, February 2021. They've pushed it off till next year, as with most movies that were supposed to come out this summer, they've been pushed off till next year. But the Pedal movie, I was interviewed for that, and we did talk about that very question, why is it called a pedal? And I gave a very good explanation in that interview, which I don't know if they'll put it in the movie or not, but basically, it's sort of a legacy term. Pedals were originally all pedals. They're all foot-operated things, and it comes from electronic pedals that were made for organs back in the 40s and 50s, and also for lap steel players in the 50s and 60s. And so between organs and lap steel, there were lots of different pedals that were made for volume control and also tone control. And so the term pedal comes from those original pedals, because when guitar players started using them, taking these control pedals from organs and lap steels and using them with for guitars, particularly the volume and the tone control pedals, that you could get some crazy effects. There was one pedal, and I really wish I had like a picture of it, but I had heard about it, you know, decades ago. I'd never seen one, but I'd heard that there was, like, early on an organ pedal that guitar players had started to use before stomp boxes came out, like in back in the 40s, 50s. And it was a pedal that it was like had two different axes. It had like a pitch axis where it would control the volume, that had this yaw axis where it controlled the tone. So if you had your foot on it, you could control the volume and the tone with one control, and guitar players could use this to get all kinds of weird effects. And I had heard, like, you know, Jimmy Bryant and Speedy West and stuff would get all these weird, you know, kind of wah-wah-wah effects, you know, using this pedal, varying the volume and the tone. and, you know, getting this whack wow sound, you know, and doing licks on the guitar. But that's really where it comes from. It comes from those original organ and lap steel pedals. And then after stomp boxes came out, you know, the Gibson was the first, you know, with the Gibson fuzz, and then went from there, you know, fuzz face and, you know, Univibe and all that stuff. But we just used pedal as a generic term for all of the sort of controls and effects that end up on the floor, whether or not you actually use your foot to control it. We just call them pedals, and the name stuck, so that's it. That's about it for this one. This has kind of got a little long with the ranting and all that, but okay, so that's it for this one. I'll be back here at the bench doing something interesting real soon, or maybe over at the factory. I got some stuff to do over there. Lots of stuff going on, so anyway, that's it. I'm Fran. Thanks for watching. Thanks, too, to everyone down there on that Patreon. Making all these videos possible, even if I'm just ranting, not actually like doing anything. The patrons are still keeping the lights on, these very lights, you know. If you like these videos, even this one, I don't know why, but if you like what I do, consider supporting the channel and becoming a patron. Just follow the link in the description, become a patron. Helps me keep the ads down and everything. I'm not doing mid-roll ads. I don't have all those crazy ads popping up in the middle, all that. I won't do that. I don't have to do that, and I won't do that so long as Patreon is keeping the bills paid. So there you go. Keeping the ads at a minimum, just the minimum required by YouTube. If I didn't have to run ads at all to get my videos shared, I would run no ads, but we already went through that. YouTube doesn't allow that, so. Minimum ads, just the minimum required ads. All right. Thanks, patrons. I'll see you soon. Bye. At the bench.